you a little bit about yourself before we kick off our session?
Sure. So I work at Good Shepherd. I'm a business development lead there. Previously used to work at Sony with that gentleman who's sitting there. And previous to that used to work at Sega with that gentleman who's sitting there. So basically my audiences are my former colleagues, which can either be really good or really bad. Depending on how this goes. Yeah, for sure. Especially from that point. I do business development and curation and green lighting at Good Shepherd, which is a new publishing label, who are a sister company to Devolver. Previous to that, I was a strategic content at Sony for almost 5 years, where our job was essentially to reach out to developers and receive pitches on a daily basis. So I've seen every kind of pitch you can imagine, every flavor of pitch you can imagine.
Cool. So the idea here is that we've been speaking to our friends in the internet community and taking to Twitter. So basically get like sort of the top going question that developers have for someone, like who are you going to pitch someone in the future? And I'll put long list of them here. So, should we go first?
Sure.
Yeah. Cool. First question is, what are the three biggest mistakes I've made in the pitch?
Right. So, the really obvious ones are not having anything to show and not being clear about what it is that you want. So that happens surprisingly often, even with quite experienced developers. And when I've reached out before online to kind of find out, you know, why wouldn't you say what you want? I've been in situations with my colleagues before, like strategic content, where I've had a great pitch, a great game, and someone's had a video or go to show, and it's what it is that's special about this game, but they haven't been explicit and clear about what it is that they actually want. And there's a lot of problems with that, which I won't delve into now, very rambling, but essentially, I can't help you, and no investor can help you if they don't know exactly what it is that you're asking for. And it seems like a really obvious thing, but the fear is that people are worried about you not overselling or understanding themselves and having the door closed. The reality is this will be confirmed by other people in this line of business. It's all about building a relationship, and the door will never close. You know, people will be clear if they can't hit that particular scope or scale. But if you kind of have a very practical kind of Chinese menu approach to it, you won't scare people off, you know, if you're willing to be flexible. So really it's just not being clear about what you want, not having something to show, you know, in terms of having a bill. There's really no excuse to not be something to show someone if you ask them for money, particularly if you ask them for a lot of money. It shows that you've got skin in the game, and it shows that you actually believe in what it is that you're selling. The third thing is a bit more nebulous and vague, but it's something that I care about a lot, which is that people go into pitches quite often with the wrong mentality. And I'll kind of skew this question a bit and not be so much about the mistakes that people make, but more about how they can get pitches right. And people that have done the right thing, avoiding that mistake to be successful with me, is you need to go to a pitch with the right attitude of courting and building a relationship. Because sometimes, no matter what, you might not be able to work on a specific project. But the silver lining needs to be that you've built a relationship and you've got a connection. And that can really pay off down the line. And those are the kind of people that I would like to work with and establish a nice rapport. So you need to go into it thinking outside of the box. And that's a lot of people make the mistake of just being very laser focused and blinkered about it. Just needs to be about conveying why the game is great. But the reality is, you don't just sign stuff because the game is great. That's a given. There needs to be more beyond that than certain kinds of value.
What's the strangest pitch you have ever seen?
No, obviously. It's the strangest pitch I've ever received. I received a pitch where people came in cosplaying as characters from their game. That's probably the strangest pitch I've ever received. Yeah. And it was a good pitch because I remembered them. And to that previous point that I just made, we didn't actually sign that game, but they were so enthusiastic, and that's a really important element to have when you do go to a pitch, enthusiasm and having fun with it, that we did actually go back to them in the end for something else and work with them. And that that kind of cornering and really making an impression. But you have to have the talent to back it up. You have to demonstrate the capability. So it isn't just the case of doing something a bit wacky like that. But that was definitely strange at the time, getting dressed like the characters.
Well, to add to that, have there been pitches that you personally loved but have known to work with the team for whatever reason?
Yeah, for sure. So, I mean, that would happen a lot for whatever reason. So whether, as someone that takes a lot of pitches on board, whether I'm working for a publisher or working for a platform holder, you know, all of these groups will have their own business objectives. And you have to pretty much toe the line, you know, to a certain extent, and make sure that you're serving their needs as far as possible. And sometimes a game you really love, whether it's the genre, whether it's the developer, they're making something that fits in with what your business objectives are, and sometimes it doesn't. You know, when it's your job from a pitching perspective to really do your research and have a sense of what space could I fill, what problem could I solve for the person that I'm pitching to. And that way you avoid just having that issue of you've got a great game, again, talking outside the box and going to someone and saying, I've got a great game. It's like, yeah, I agree it's a great game, but this is not what we're looking for. And if you've done your research, you could have avoided that. And awkwardness of being in that position. But I spent a lot of time, a big part of pitching and a big part of building that rapport is spending the due diligence with you is building that relationship up over time to make sure that you never get to that point where it's my job to make sure that I'm the filter and that people, you know, I'm not letting it get to a point where the management team has to greenlight it and be like, well, yeah, this game's great, we agree, but this does nothing for us as a publishing label or as a platform.
That's a question now, but how far along does the product have to be before it's pitched?
It really depends on the level of investment you're looking for. As I said, I think in this day and age, not having a prototype, not having a build, there's obviously circumstances in which that would be the case, but by and large, I would say you would have to have a build. In terms of how far along that needs to be, you know, certain platform holders and publishers would require that you have essentially what equates to a vertical slice, a very polished demo. And that's also true if you're asking for a lot of money. So if you're talking in the millions rather than the thousands, then it needs to be very, very polished. It needs to answer some key questions. Again, it depends on what they're looking for. Are they looking for something that's strategic, that breaks the mold? Or are they looking for something that is known, that reaches an audience that they understand, but maybe puts a spin on the existing genre or the existing mechanic. You know, in those, it really depends on the scope of the game and the needs of the investor that you're pitching to or the publisher that you're pitching to. But at the bare minimum, you would need to have a playable build in the show. And that could just be program art and just kind of really basic. I've signed stuff that's had program art and no kind of visual pass on it, because the key element that we're interested in are the mechanics and the feel of those mechanics and how tactile they were. So as long as you can make that.
Phillips asked for money, should they ask for as little as they need to get the game made, or is it like okay to maybe ask for?
You shouldn't ask for as little as you need. You should ask for what you need to get the game made. Always put in a runway of contingency into your calculations, because that you'll always take longer than you actually need. So you make sure you've got enough flexibility there, and you've got the cash flow, which you can work out with the investor in terms of the payment structure that you want to work on. But always ask for exactly what you need to deliver what it is that you say that you're going to deliver. Don't be worried about having the door shut in your face to that point that I made earlier and asking for too little. And if you're not sure, you know, what the publisher can afford or what they can do, as I said, go in a tier one, tier two, tier three, you know, for this amount, this is my dream. If I could get this amount, I would deliver this on this timeline. But for less, I can deliver this. You know, you're going to lose that. And, you know, and that's the way that you kind of build that dynamic and rapport and figure out what it is that they're looking for. You know, they might say, yeah, we really care about having all that stuff, but we really like this and we want to go on that side, and that's a more affordable package for them. So don't just think of it as a kind of, it's not, in many ways, pitching is kind of analogous to interviews, but it's not exactly like an interview. You know, you have got one shot and that's it. It is the start of the courting process of a relationship, so feel free to never sell yourself short, don't ask for too much. Be very clear, because the last thing you want to do is say, I can make this and for this amount on this timeline and not deliver on that promise.
Is it okay to ask for a publisher to break down their publishing costs and spending?
Yeah, absolutely. If you're going into a relationship where you're not looking for development funding in particular, or even if you are looking for some of that, if you're looking for a distribution and marketing relationship and support on that side, then you, from a publishing perspective, you absolutely should be questioning and asking during that initial conversation what amount would they put into something based on their, you know, based on the investment that you've put in, based on the audience that you want to hit, what kind of, you know, product campaign they would build out of it. A lot of that would come later down the line, but you, from the gate, you want to be very clear about how much spend they're going to put into the game. And you want that in the agreement as well. That isn't just a part of the conversation. You want a very clear breakdown of, you know, what amount is going into QA and love. You know, they'll ask, when you start having a more detailed conversation with the publisher, they'll be asking how many words you put in the game, what the game is. They'll work out their QA and love costs. But then they'll also have their kind of publishing expenses that go into the game. So, you know, everything around that, and you'll want to have that breakdown as well to understand what they'll be putting into the game.
Could you tell us a bit about the process between developing a pitch game to publisher and that game then being lit? And as well, I think, if you tell us a bit about some of the differences between that for publisher and Shepherd.
Right. I mean, I can't really...
Is that the difference?
Yeah, I mean, the caveat here is I can't really speak about, specifically about Sony, not because I'm not there anymore, but because what I did there is not necessarily what's happening there right now, so it wouldn't be right of me to say that. In terms of Good Shepherd, the process that we have is pretty straightforward. You know, when you're a digital publisher and you're working with independent developers, you can be fairly flexible and kind of pivot. You know, we have a very stringent curation process. You know, I'm a really big believer in the fact that the way that you avoid kind of retroactive production and quality control and steering, or minimize that, is by doing the due diligence early on and making sure that initial conversation and process is very, very clear. So you always do that torch up and steer people appropriately down the line when you inevitably hit, you know, bumps in the road, rather than just kind of diving into something and then having to deal with any kind of production headaches that inevitably come up later in a more drastic way. So the process we have is a very stringent prospecting process where we have a prospect team that goes through an initial kind of filtering process, which is stage one. And then we kind of have a Slack group and a call every week, and we just go through all the things and discuss them and pay the bills and give our opinions and totally free form it. If it goes through that stage and we're all happy with it, and it's not a democracy, to be clear, it is just, eventually it's just me saying yes or no. But the opinions are kind of valuable in that group. It's best to have a small group. We don't want too many chefs in the kitchen, or cooks in the kitchen, so you know, it's three or four people maximum. And then it goes to the second phase, which is a kind of budget and forecast stage. So, you know, we've had the initial discussion, but, you know, we've looked at whether this philosophically makes sense in our portfolio, and we're interested in it, and we like the developers, and we feel that they can deliver. Let's just do the numbers and make sure this makes commercial sense as well. Because they, you know, those things are run parallel, they're not separate, really. And if that works, then finally goes to a green light stage. And all in all, that process should be relatively quick. You know, it could be anything from like 2 weeks to 6 weeks, but on average, somewhere in between. Because you don't want to drag it on. You know, people are trying to run business, trying to keep their studio running, so you have to be sensitive to that. But by the same token, you can't just dive in. So you have to really kind of build that relationship up and figure out what you're doing, From a platform perspective, it's a bit different. You might have a few more hoops to jump through. The budget's maybe bigger. You have to make sure that you're hitting the business objectives for, you know, in certainly your Microsoft case, you know, platform, you know, requirements, things that really support the platform, that help other developers through your project down the line, that they can really draw out the value from that. So there's probably more boxes that you need to tick. You know, they'll still go through that kind of due diligence, but they probably will have a couple more stages in terms of managers that will have to sign stuff off. But to be honest, the best person to ask is that man there in terms of Microsoft. If you ever catch him afterwards, he'll kind of take you through that process. But everyone has slightly different processes, but that's roughly the process. It's usually initial filter and curation, and then kind of commercial number crunching, and then the final kind of green light with the manager.
Would you say developers dress a certain way
to dress a certain way?
Yeah,
cosplay. No, you know, it's not an interview. You know, dress the way you like. But it's a lot of people worry about that kind of stuff, especially kind of younger developers.
They kind of think that's smart.
Yeah, you know, just be yourself.
How many people should do an image?
I mean, there's no right number for that. It's really, you know, it's down to how many people you think can add something valuable to that conversation, that pitch. You know, if it's just one person that really holds the vision and is able to convey that, that's fine. If it's, you know, you don't have too many people, I guess, you know, you might have four people that are just sitting there not saying anything, not two people that are talking. I mean, that just really depends on who holds the vision and who feels most comfortable just socially kind of interacting and building that relationship.
We're closing up on time here. Are there any questions from the audience for Ben?
No, including, well, those two. You can ask questions, Ben.
No questions to you, stupid, by the way.
Yeah, no questions to you, stupid. The thing about pitching is, I think a lot of people go into it worried that it's just one shot and it is this kind of most interview situation, but it's not. You can ask really silly questions. A lot of things that people trip up on are those trivial things. You know, you kind of go into it and they're so kind of worked up, and actually it's fine. And it's just about building a rapport and getting something out of it down the line. It's not just that one pitch. As much as you may want that one thing to get signed, there's a much bigger gap. So,
if
you're asking anything, you can sound
stuff,
or afterwards, if you're
embarrassed
to ask it.
Yeah,
go on.
Can you expand on the difference of pitching to a platform versus a publisher?
Yeah.
You touched on it already, but...
Yeah, I mean, for me, it's kind of, you know, to an extent. So the thing with pitching to a publisher, a lot of pitching is about doing your research and about having empathy and about thinking about what the person on the other side of the table needs. Like, and that's what I meant about. It's not just about having a great game. You need to convey what is valuable about your game to that person. Like, and you need to understand that. And that's going to be different for a platform holder than it is to a publisher A or publisher B. So what Sega means is going to be different than what Annapurna is and what Devolver means. And that's not just looking at it from a portfolio perspective in terms of the kinds of games that they release, but thinking about it from, you know, doing your research and having it, trying to understand these are the kind of things they're talking about, and this potentially is the direction they're moving in, and this is the way the market is moving in kind of broad terms. And from a platform perspective, very broadly speaking, console platforms, you know, and I've been through a couple of cycles with PS3 and PS4, as Aggo's been through many cycles. Essentially, you'll have a strategic phase really early on, and then in the second half of the life cycle of the console, you'll have a tactical phase. In terms of the way that their business objectives are defined. And what that means is really early on, they're looking at things that will help give a kind of a halo value from a third-party perspective to their portfolio, and really help that platform shine in terms of the specific platform features and system software features they have. They will continue to support that, but they'll be looking at how they can really squeeze out as much as they can and reach slightly different segments that challenge other platforms, whether that's PC or whether that's the other consoles, later on. Whereas early on, they're looking at really kind of championing and promoting kind of in a kind of very arrow-headed, really forward-thinking and strategic way their platform. It's less about other platforms, it's more about how they can really define the role of their platform. But later on, they do less of that. So they start taking fewer bets on third-party developers, but they make more kind of tactical bets on projects that they think can reach those segments that they haven't quite reached, or reach their existing segments, but make sure that they hit those audiences in a really impactful way. So that's the way that when you approach a platform holder, it's slightly different than approaching a publisher, where it's much more based on what is the need from an investment perspective, what are the portfolio needs. So it's a slightly different question. You're not thinking about that when you approach a platform holder. They've got slightly more nebulous platform needs that you need to tie into, and you need to think about how can I really help support this platform, how can I be there day one. So this game might not be doing anything necessarily that's revolutionary in the genre, but it might be the kind of thing that their first party group, and you don't really know any other third party games are doing, that you know that 2 years down the line they're going to have a new platform, whether that's PSVR, or they've got a thing like Playmate, you know, Microsoft, they've got Scorpio, or Xbox. So you need to think about what's coming down the line and how can I work with the platform holder, and that's going to be slightly different. And then really have that conversation with those guys to kind of understand what would give you the best opportunity to shine and get the support that you need on the platform in terms of visibility and store presence, which is very different than a publisher conversation in terms of publishers.
I think it's actually where it's coming from.
Yeah, sorry. You can grab me afterwards. I know someone else had a question at the back, but I go, this guy, he's always hogging his face.
Oh, yeah. Jeremy, thank you, Ben, for giving us time speaking today.